Hello, it's Randi Rhodes. Here's a clip from our show, and go to randirhodes.com for the whole thing and a podcast. Buy a stinking podcast.
Mary, how does it look?
The fault.
We believe that all men are created equal.
To the magnificent mosaic that is America.
From radio beacon to radio beacon.
I have a dream.
Change has come to America.
Knock, knock. Who's there?
It's a figment of your imagination.
Randi Rhodes Show. Turn up your mind.
It's Friday, you bastards.
How about your movies now?
Yes! You are so white. Oh my God. This is the whitest, whitest staff I've ever worked with as a black woman and a black journalist, I must say. That was beautiful. Absolutely festive today. We're just festive. Why? Because private prisons, federal private prisons. Bye-bye. Bye. Woo. That's a great freaking story. I don't know why there wasn't more hoopla about it. Oh, yes, I do. It's because Donald Trump is still running for, media mogul or something, or dog catcher, or, president of the United States. So, yeah, they cover him like a wet blanket, like the humidity in Florida, like the fires in California, like the floodwaters in Louisiana. They're just, they're covering. They're covering and hovering is what they're doing. But, listen, he did make a little news last night, I will say. A little tiny bit, because he sort of, I guess Kellyanne Conway said, "Now, Donald, you really must apologize for the crap you've been saying. It's really, really bad. You have 0% of the black vote. You have less than 20% of the Latino vote. Women in droves in suburbia are running away from you like crazy. And now, the all-important white male vote, you're losing that too, honey. It's not good for you." And he's probably, "Well, I don't really give a rat's ass because I'm going to start a media company and that's what this is all about. I told them I was running against the media. I'm not running against Hillary. I'm not running against her. I'm just up here insulting her because that's what our network's going to do the whole time she's president is what we're going to do. And all my pretty little surrogates out there, they're going to be hosting that thing. So Kellyanne, what is your point?" Well, Donald, you have to make it look like you're doing something. You have to make it look like you were almost president. And don't you want to cover the election on your new channel and say how it was rigged? That's what built Fox News. That's what made them. Don't you remember the butterfly ballot in Florida in 2000 and Teresa Lepore and Cruella DeVille at the Secretary of State of Florida? Don't you remember all that? That's how they got on the map, Donald. That's how they got on the map. Well, how did MSNBC do it? Well, they did it back in the day, okay? They did it on the OJ trial. They were called America's Talking. But nobody was until OJ. And then, Geraldo came and hosted a show, and it did pretty damn good, and they built a whole network out of that. But Geraldo works for Fox. Right, Roger Ailes works for you. Smarten up. Well, I don't understand. Why can't I just start my media empire? Because, Donald, all these millions and millions and millions of primary voters, they are your audience for your media channel. And you can't pretend, you can't let them down at the end of the election. You have to make it look like you're still fighting for it, or else they won't watch. And how are we going to sell Big Pharma on millions of viewers if they don't watch? And the banks, Donald, and the banks. They're going to advertise with you. You know that Chinese bank you like to brag about in your building? They'll buy ads. So he tried to say, okay, I'll apologize generally. It's kind of a Brian Lochte moment for him. Brian Lochte also apologized today for not being accurate about the way he didn't remember being so drunk at 6:30 in the morning. He's really sorry that he wished he remembered more about being drunk and breaking down a bathroom door and whizzing on the floor. He really wishes he remembers more about tearing down a sign and breaking a mirror and, cab drivers refusing to drive him. He wishes he remembered. And Donald Trump wishes that, in the heat of debate or some crap, How is this possible? He's said these things over and over and over and over again. He has called Mexicans rapists. He has said Muslims should be banned. He wants extreme vetting, extreme vetting, extreme vetting. Three times he said the extreme vetting is what he said. There's my African-American. There you are. Look at you. You get it. You get it. That's my African-American. You know, John McCain's not a war hero. I guess he said that in the heat of some debate that I missed somehow, even though I've watched and recorded every damn one of them. The NFL sent him a letter saying, don't debate on NFL night because, Donald, because you'll ruin our ratings. No, they didn't. You know, so what is he apologizing? I don't even know. I assume he was trying to apologize to African Americans. I'm assuming that this was like a sorry black people thing, because I think Kellyanne Conway said, you know, we could make a case that Obama hasn't been able to deliver for his own people, which is racist to begin with, that the president isn't the president of all the people. That the president, because the president is black, is only president of the black people. And therefore, we could make a case that Obama let down his people, which are not all Americans. It's just black Americans. And they're doing worse, Donald. They're doing worse. So, and that's because we have a crappy Congress. We have Mitch McConnell heading up the Senate. You had Boehner over there in the House. Until, of course, Bannon got him out of there. Bannon ran a million anti-Boehner articles. And now Paul Ryan's in there. And, of course, when Donald Trump didn't endorse Paul Ryan, didn't play into the plan, didn't play into the plan. So get out there and endorse Paul Ryan. And then he was like, fine. Oh, what'd you think I was going to say? All right, so this is his attempt at the apology.
Sometimes in the heat of debate and speaking on a multitude of issues, you don't choose the right words or you say the wrong thing.
Off the cuff.
I have done that.
Over and over.
And believe it or not, I regret it.
The Trump apology tour. Trump apology tour. Trump apology tour.
And I do regret it,
what
particularly
what does he,
where it may have caused personal pain.
You mean when someone got hit in the face?
Too much is at stake for us to be consumed with these issues. But one thing I can promise you this, I will always tell you the truth.
Okay, spit take. Time for the spit take. I knew not to pick up the coffee during that clip because I knew he'll always tell you the truth. He'll always tell. So was he for or against going into Libya?
I was never for a strong intervention. I could have seen surgical where you take out Gaddafi and his group. You do a surgical shot and you take him out.
Okay.
But I wasn't for what happened.
We would be so much better off if Gaddafi were in charge right now.
The world would be better off with Saddam Hussein
100%.
And Gaddafi in power.
100%.
We should do on a humanitarian basis, immediately go into Libya, knock this guy out very quickly, very surgically, very effectively, and save the lives.
She lies so much.
She lies.
She said Donald Trump wants Japan to put in nuclear weapons. No, no, no.
Maybe they would, in fact, be better off if they defend themselves from North Korea. Maybe
with
we
nukes.
Would be better off, including with nukes. Yes,
I was totally
I'll never
against
lie to you.
The war in Iraq, very proudly, saying for many years that it would destabilize the Middle East.
Are you for invading Iraq?
Yeah, I guess so. You know, I wish it was. I wish the first time it was done correctly.
Okay, so let's get this right. He'll never lie to you except when he does. And he's sorry for some damn thing that he said off the cuff over and over and over again, especially if it caused you personal pain. You mean like if you got punched in the face or dragged out of one of his, rail? What do you mean personal pain? What does that mean? I'm not sure what he's referring to. I'm like, you know, personal pain. Like, is that refusing, agreeing to pay the legal fees for somebody if you hit one of his campaigns, one of his rally supporters who, you know, hits a protest and he'll pay the legal fees? Is that the one I can't tell what he's talking about. Can you tell what he's talking about? I'm not sure. He was not specific enough. It's very Ryan Lochte. It's very Lochte. You know, I mean, this is a man who, listen, There's a beautiful article. You want it? It's in my homework section. It's from the Huffington Post today. It looks at the 40 years, the 40 years of Donald Trump's racism. Okay? Let's remember he was the number one birther in this country. Let's remember that. Let's remember that Donald Trump not only was a birther, which shows racism, okay, because he said that Obama was not a legitimate president. He wasn't born here. He was born in Kenya. He denied the birth certificate when he was presented with the birth certificate. He said his mother was in the hospital. But he also lied because he said, remember, Donald Trump said that he was gonna, that he had sent people to Hawaii, and you won't believe what they're finding. That was 2011. This is 5 years later. They didn't find nothing. He freaking lies, okay? He also said the president was a secret Muslim. He also said that Obama only got into Columbia and Harvard, where he was the editor of the Law Review. He said he only got into those schools because of affirmative action. Okay, Donald Trump has said some racist things, and this is just the recent past that, you know, you and me remember. But looking back, it does dawn on me as a New Yorker growing up there that in 1989, Donald Trump, there was this big, horrible rape thing that happened in Central Park. And there were five black guys who were accused of doing this raping. And Donald Trump spent almost $90,000 putting ads, full page ones, in expensive newspapers like the New York Times and the Daily News. He put full page ads in there, spent $85,000 to $90,000, demanding that New York bring back the death penalty and fry these guys who he said committed these this heinous rape in Central Park. Turns out, these five guys were innocent. Yeah, they were innocent. And so that was 1989. You might say, oh, Randy, that's 1989. Right, okay, but in 2013, when he figured out how to tweet, Donald Trump tweeted thusly, what were they doing in Central Park? Playing checkers? He can't let it go. Donald Trump fights every old fight that he's ever had. And plus, let's not forget all the painstaking time that I took to read to you how the lawsuits that Donald Trump's family went through when they refused to rent to black renters. They owned about 20,000 apartments in New York City, and his father and Donald would not rent to black renters. They sent in white people to fill out an application to lease an apartment right after black people had been told there was no room at the end. They didn't have any apartments. And of course, the white people were told, oh, you want to see one? Do you want to see an apartment? And, you know, when will you need it? How long will you want it for? You want a 1 year lease? Right. And so they lost that case. They lost that case. And Donald Trump freaking appealed that case, lost again. And then 3 years later, he was caught doing it again. Am I lying or is he lying? John O'Donnell, who was the former president at Trump Plaza Casino in Atlantic City, has quoted Donald Trump saying, black people counting my money, I hate it. I want short guys wearing yarmulkes. Okay, that crosses lots of boundaries. The black staff in the Plaza Casino was ordered to leave the floor and stay in the back where the customers couldn't see them. I mean, this is 40 years of crap. Never mind what he said in this campaign with, their murderers, their rapists, Judge Curiel. He's a Mexican. He can't sit in judgment of me because his parents came here from Mexico. Now that, you know. Mrs. Khan wasn't allowed to speak at the Democratic National Convention because Muslims don't respect women. As if Donald Trump respects women. He told Chris Matthews that women should be punished for having an abortion and that we should go back to back alleys. You know, he said what they used to do is what they'll do. They'll go to some illegal place, you know, and they'll get an abortion. Really? Yeah, they should be punished. And Chris said, how? 10 years in prison? Well, he goes, I don't know. It's a complicated issue. Did he mean that? Was he apologizing for that? Was he apologizing for Megyn Kelly's bleeding from the eyes and various other body parts? Was he apologizing for mocking a disabled reporter? I don't know. Which one? I don't know. Solakti. I can't figure it out.
For a commercial-free, on-demand, whenever, wherever listening experience. Visit randyrhodes.com for your personal premium podcast today. To speak to Randi, call now, you bastards. 561-270-3844.
Hello, hello.
Randi Rhodes.
Randi Rhodes.
Air Force.
We will reject bigotry and hatred and oppression in all of its forms and seek a new future built on our common culture and values as one American people.
Yeah. What?
This is the change.
What is that?
I am promising to all of you an honest government, a great economy, and a just society for each and every American. But we can never, ever fix our problems by relying on the same politicians who created these problems in the first place. Can't do it.
Can't have it. I can't do it. I can't have it, Paulie. I can't do it.
Can't be done.
Can't have it. I just can't have it. She's got to go home. So if we have to reject bigotry, doesn't mean we have to reject you. We have to reject you. You're the biggest bigot that's come down the pike since Barry Goldwater. Extremism is no vice. You know, this is Donald Trump's mantra. Was he lying when he said he knew Putin, or is he not lying? Did he know him? Doesn't he know? And what the hell happened with Paul Manafort? Wow, I told you, didn't we tell you? I told you that man did not register as a foreign agent. He's in deep doo-doo, man. That's why he resigned today. Because he's definitely going to, be charged with, representing foreign governments, not on the side of America, without registering as a foreign agent. And you're supposed to do that. That is the rule. I don't know why we allow it at all, but we do, as long as you're registered. It's like, you got to register for everything except a gun. It's amazing. It's just you could represent anti-Western commie governments and make, millions of dollars doing it, as long as you sign this form.
You said it yesterday.
What?
That this was going to happen.
Well, I mean, this was very obvious to me when we started reading the articles about, Manafort in Ukraine. It was just so obvious to me that he was a lobbyist, right? And so that, lobbyists, I live with one, so I know some of the rules. And it was very obvious that, the question was whether or not he had registered as a foreign agent, that, he had told the United States, that he told people that he would, right? Yeah, it was, what?
Okay.
What?
What
are you doing?
It's not just registration. He also had to submit every single email, letter, any contact he had actually has to be presented to the Justice Department. Oh. So it's not just registration. It's ongoing filings. He never put a thing in there. So I thought you'd like to know.
Well, thank you, Howard. This is what happens when you live with a lobbyist, a big one. Huge. No, I made him stop. I made him stop. When we first met, it was like plaid and floral. You'd say that never goes together, but sometimes it does. Sometimes it does. All right, let's go to Keith in Oakland, California.
Hi.
Hey.
Randi, how are you?
Hi, Keith.
How are you?
I'm all right. It's Friday. How bad could it be?
Oh, it could be better if this election was over.
80 days, I think. 79. Are we down in the 70s?
Woo-hoo.
Yeah. Woohoo.
Well, I'm calling. Big fan. Glad you're back. We all missed you very much. But I'm also calling about a call you had yesterday for a voter that wanted to support Jill Stein.
Yeah.
In the general election.
Yeah. The guy in California.
And he was from California?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought he was from Ohio.
No, he's from California. He was from California. Oh. And so what we said about Ohio was, he said, I'll know how Ohio swung before my polls close. So I said, well, that's probably true. So he said, well, can I vote for Jill Stein if it's all wrapped up? I mean, if she got to 270, can I vote for Jill Stein? And I said, yeah, why not?
Oh, yeah. No, that makes perfect sense. I thought he said he was from Ohio.
Oh, hell no. No,
I got worried.
No, no swing states. No swing states get to vote for Jill Stein. Sorry. I mean, I'm in Florida. There's no way. There's no way I could skip it.
I know.
There's no way I can skip it. There's no way I got. First of all, I don't have a problem voting for her. I know everybody thinks that I do. It's not me that does. There are people, who have microphones who have a huge problem with her. That would not be me. I don't have a huge problem with voting for her. I'm not gonna have to hold my nose and vote for her. I am going to vote for her. I'm not voting against Donald Trump. I'm voting for her.
Yes.
All right. But nobody in a swing state, nobody in a swing state gets to vote a third party.
I know. They could steal Ohio, Pennsylvania, and Florida, and it'd be over. So
Virginia also.
Listen.
Colorado.
Listen. Swag. Thanks for the swag.
What swag did you get?
T-shirt and a mug so far.
Oh, very nice. Yeah, I have that too. How do you like that stuff? Isn't this nice?
Yeah. Can I tell you, when you went off the air, I tried to have some T-shirts made, like, come back. And
aww.
Of course, they wouldn't let me use your image. So that didn't go anywhere.
You don't want my image on your chest. I don't want my image on my chest. It's my chest and I don't want it. It's not a very good idea, but thank you. Kendrick in Fort Lauderdale.
Yeah, hi, Randi.
Hello.
Listen to you for a long, long time when you were on the air.
Thank you.
And it's great that you're back.
Thank you.
Great that you're back. But we are in disagreement today.
Oh, great.
I have a problem with Hillary Clinton, not because she's a woman, but just her statements. You went over how Donald Trump made some statements that were kind of in a tone of blaspheming and saying different things. Those Hillary Clinton.
They weren't blasphemous. They were ugly and racist and bigoted and lies.
I agree.
I agree.
I agree. And so did Hillary Clinton. I remember I was in this country when she came out and she called young black men super predators.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And to me, any person of color should be just disqualify her for saying that straight away.
Well, here's the thing. Hillary Clinton, since she said that back in the 90s, has redeemed herself with the black community. And she, her husband had one of the most successful economic plans that we've seen come down the pike in quite some time that benefited, everybody, but also the African-American community. And so, African-Americans have forgiven Hillary Clinton for that statement. Although, do you remember the first speech that Hillary Clinton made when she started running this time?
No, I don't remember the first speech, but it was about
criminal justice reform, because that's something that obviously has been burning in her gut, telling her that she did do that saying the super predator thing, that being wrong on the issue of the 1994 crime bill, which, she was first lady, but she was for it. Let's not mince words here. I mean, she was definitely for it.
And President Clinton signed it.
Of course.
More black people have been incarcerated at that time.
Yes, it's a horror story.
So people need to remember the truth and not gloss over.
Right, that is the truth. There's no question that is the truth. But there's more truth to be told since 1994. There's more truth to be told. Today, that's why I started the show with this. For me, this is a big damn deal. Federal private prisons are not to re-sign any contracts and are not to enter into any new contracts. And the two big prison corporations, one of them's based here in Florida, GEO, and the other one, the Corrections Corporation of America, CCA, I guess, which is really kind of creepy if you love the movie Network. But they were told their stock plummeted today because we're not going to do private prisons anymore. You know, there is a point in time when you say something that you're for. For instance, let's serve me up on a platter today. Why not? It's Friday, and I have thick skin. But remember in 2008, I had gone to do stand-up comedy, which apparently I've decorated my new studio in the, genre of the Haha Club or Captain Hoo-Ha's or something. But anyway, I went to try and do stand-up comedy, which I had never done before, and I tested it out in a gay nightclub in San Francisco on a Saturday night because they're a very friendly audience towards me. So I went out there and I did 10 minutes. And in that 10 minutes, I had called myself an effing whore. I'd called a lot of people an effing whore. Elliot Spitzer an effing whore, blah, blah, blah. But I had also picked on Hillary Clinton and Geraldine Ferraro. And I called Geraldine Ferraro David Duke in drag. Why did I call her that? Because she said Obama would not be where he was if he weren't black, and that his blackness was what was making him popular, which was, I mean, Obama's reply to that was so crazy good. He said, that's right. You know, if you want to be popular in America and you want to run for president, you want your name to be Barack Hussein Obama. Right. That's right. So, you know, he shut her down. But that's what that stand-up comedy bit was about in 2008. Here we are 8 years later. I'm voting for her. I don't have a problem with it.
I don't understand it. I really don't understand.
Because
it
was comedy gone awry is what it is.
Your comedy is fine. If Donald Trump
is asking forgiveness for all these many, many things that he said over and over and over and over again, even when given the chance to say, do you take it back? He said, no, I mean it. I mean what I say. I say what I mean. I am myself. I'm comfortable in my skin. I say what I... Okay, so... But if somebody asked me, you know, do I regret, doing that stand-up comedy? I wouldn't regret that I tried it. I'm glad I did. Because I learned how hard it is, and I learned how dangerous it can be in the wrong hands, which many of my stand-up friends told me. They said, be careful. Be careful.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Well, back on task with Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
Especially with Bill Clinton. I have a problem with Bill Clinton getting back in the White House, which is a completely different
Why?
Story.
Why? He's 70 but years old.
I don't care.
Okay,
don't
what's
care.
The
what
problem?
Was bad.
What is the problem?
What he did was bad with the intern.
I think she's over it too.
She could be over it.
Yeah, I think she is.
It, but I don't want to see any more of it. But the most important thing, we have Hillary Clinton is running.
Listen, if I would rather, I would rather have a sex scandal than I would a nuclear scandal. I would rather have a sex scandal than I would like to see a Muslim internment camps.
No, that's never going to happen. You know that.
How do I know that? These Republicans in Congress are batshit crazy. What are you talking about?
That's ever going to happen.
Wait a minute.
I'm going to tell you one thing that's really a possible thing, though.
Yeah.
I will tell you something that will be a possible thing.
Yeah.
Extreme vetting. I totally agree with extreme vetting. And here's something else that no one is talking about.
If we extremely vetted the Trump supporters, they wouldn't be allowed in the United States either.
You could be right at that point. You could be right.
Right.
But here's something that's really happening right now that no one's talking about. Did you know that Mexico wants to build a wall to keep immigrants from coming into their country?
What the hell are you reading Breitbart? Are you reading Drudge?
No. No.
Okay. So direct me to this newsy article that I will be informed, properly.
I will direct it to it.
Yes, direct me to Mexico wants to build a wall and pay for it. I would love to see that, because I will tell you this, and I've said this a million times since he said it. Any country that walls in its own people is going to have terrorism. Any country.
You're European. Remember,
East Germany.
Yes.
Okay.
That's what I was about to say. You're correct in that statement.
So how am I wrong on anything I just said? Really?
Well, we have to do something.
In your world, listen, I'm sorry, but we can go round and round, but in your world, there are newspaper articles that say Mexico is building a wall and they're happy to pay for it. But in your world, there is also no chance to change a point of view on a difficult subject. There's just no chance to do that. There's no chance to make good. There's no chance to say, I made a mistake, and that was like one of the things that I regret the most. Donald Trump's trying that tactic, except the problem is these were not off the cuff remarks. This wasn't a one-time thing with him. This racist thing that he has in his life for the last 40 years is not going away. It's not going away. The pointing out of my African American, that could have been an off the cuff remark. That could have been one example of what which is why I settled on he's trying to apologize to African Americans, only because that was off the cuff. But everything else he ever said was not off the cuff. Judge Curiel, he said that over and over and over again. Punching people in the face and he paid the legal bills. He said that at so many of his rallies during the primaries. He just kept saying, I miss the old days when you could punch someone in the face. Then he doubled down. Not only can you punch someone in the face, I'll pay the legal bills. So that wasn't off the cuff. You know, hit people hard and women and pigs and bleeding. That's not a one-time thing either. He said horrible things about Rosie O'Donnell. He said horrible things about Hillary Clinton. He said horrible things about Megyn Kelly. He said horrible things on The Apprentice. One of the girls said something like, I got down on my knees and I begged for, you know, to be given a leadership role on a team. Because I watched that show. Yes, I watch garbage TV. I love it. I love it, okay? It's another one of my flaws. I watch every housewife of whatever city. The only one that really sucked, and, you know, Andy Cohen knew it because he took it off the air, was Potomac. Howard lived in Potomac. He's like, what the hell is this show? That has nothing to do with Potomac. It's very weird. They tried to manufacture. It was just, you know, over the top because I don't believe that, you know, well, I know how those reality shows are. But I mean that the NFL sent him a letter. They didn't send him a letter. That wasn't off the cuff. That was an outright lie. He knows Putin. He couldn't have been nicer. He doesn't know Putin. You know? I mean, the guy is just, he can't stop. He can't stop. Now, if you want to say that Hillary Clinton said something once and that everything that she's done since has proven her worth to that community that she insulted, I'll listen to you because I know it's true. I know what she said. I heard what she said. Super predators. It wasn't just predators. It was super predators. I could hear it in my head. Richard in Chicago.
Hey, Randi. How are you, honey?
Oh, how are you talking to me with all the chaos and violence going on right now in your city?
Tell me about it.
Are you under a table? Are you hiding? Because it's chaos there. It's total chaos.
You know, I'm a black man, so, you know, we always hide.
Well, I'm a black woman and a black journalist, as you can plainly see.
Absolutely.
Right. So I can relate.
Listen, I had to call because of your last caller.
Yeah, okay,
listen,
good.
You know I'm black. You know me. You and I talk.
Okay. Oh, okay. Now I know who you are. Yeah.
Okay. Right. So, when Hillary said this thing about super predator, that was ages ago. Oh God, I was probably what, in my early 20s. So here I am, 49 years old, and honestly, I had forgotten all about it until it was brought back up again during this election.
Well, I will say this: it was bad. It was bad. And if you were, you know, political, and I was, okay, when she said that, I was already a talk show host. And when she said that, it was pretty outrageous. That might have sparked me to say some horrible, horrible things on the radio, okay? On the radio, really, in the 90s about that comment. I bet I did. But you know what? I was local. I was in Miami only. Okay. I worked at night, and nobody was recording every damn thing you did on a cell phone. So no one knows, right. You know, not even me, what I might have said about that. But God help you if you go do something funny off the radio. Out in San Francisco, right. On a Saturday night. Oh, well, then you can never vote for her again. Now, that's ridiculous.
Right. Okay, so if I may, please, those who are against Hillary Clinton, particularly white folks, because it seems like white people are the only ones who are bringing this crap back up. It's not, we're not upset about what Hillary said up 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
We're cool with, you know, so please don't use us as an excuse not to vote for her. That's what I'm saying.
Right. I understand. Well, thank you. Go answer your phone. I don't know what you're doing.
Okay.
You're very popular today. All right. Have a
dear
good...
Snoopy, love you.
Snoopy. Bye-bye. He loves Snoopy. Richard loves Snoopy anything. Anything. And animated ones. Oh, my God. I think he touches himself when I send him them. And I do. I look for animated Snoopy gifts for him. And I send them. But I got to tell you, you know, what people forget, what white people forget, is that the Clinton administration was able to achieve the lowest poverty rate in 20 years. Empowerment zones and the earned income tax credit that lifted 4.1 million people out of poverty. You know, her little comment, which for me was not little, I remember being upset about what she said. I remember thinking that was not the way to talk to anybody, to engender any trust. I just thought it was a kind of a deal breaker until they started legislating people out of poverty. And then you understood. They were triangulating. She was triangulating.
The Randi Rhodes Show is live on RandiRhodes.com and the free Progressive Voices app for Android and iOS. Visit the App Store or ProgressiveVoices.com now.
I am super sexually satisfied. I'm genuinely 100% more satisfied with my sex life than I was before Randi Rhodes came back on the air. Hi, I'm the Howard, and yes, it's true. I'm actually 100% more sexually satisfied than I was just one day ago. And I didn't grow a mustache. I didn't get an awesome new tattoo, and I didn't join a CrossFit gym either. I just bought a Randi Rhodes Air Force t-shirt. And when I did, I told Randi, well, there, I've done my part. How do I look in my awesome new Randi Rhodes Air Force 100% super soft cotton tee? Randi said, that's it? That's all you did to support this unfreaking, unbelievably hard effort? Okay, Howard, go fuck yourself. So I did. And I have to tell you, I still got it. Get your super soft Randi Rhodes t-shirt at RandiRhodes.com. Just click on podcasts and swag and order yours today. You'll feel a lot better after you tell Randi.
Call in, connect. To speak to Randi, call 561-270-3844. 561-270-3844.
There's a reason hedge fund managers, the financial lobbyists, the Wall Street investors are throwing their money all over Hillary Clinton, because they know she will make sure the system stays rigged in their favor. It's the powerful protecting the powerful.
All right, let's just stop there and have a look-see at Donald Trump's economic advisors, his team that he has put together, all the Steves and the billionaires, okay? Let's look at Dan DeMarco, who works for Nucor. He's a he was a former CEO of Nucor, which was a steel company. Steve Mnuchin, who is Trump's national finance director, he's chairman and CEO of the hedge fund, Duane Capital Management, Duane. Steve Roth, founder and chief executive of Vornado Realty Trust. Hedge fund billionaire John Paulson. Howard Lorber, chief executive of Vector Group. Real estate investor Tom Barrack. And bankers Stephen Kauk and Andy Beal and Steve Feinberg, a financier. Who's surrounded by hedge funders, Donald? You see, now his people hear this and, you know, they haven't been properly vetted for intelligence. So they're at these rallies unimpeded, and they don't understand that he's in bed with the same people that she's in bed with. The question is, what will he do as president? And he's told you and shown you who he is. Now, she may have said some untoward things, some wrong things. She may have had a bad vote on that Iraq war, which if there was anything that was unforgivable to me, it was Democrats who voted for the Iraq war. But it happened. I protested. I marched. I spit out a spleen. We investigated. We talked to the weapons, the chief weapons inspectors. We had them on the show. We had Hans Blix. Who was the other guy? And for all his good work that he did to tell us that Saddam Hussein had no weapons of mass destruction, he was called a child molester. I mean, the crap that went on and the buildup to that war. Now, what's fascinating is Donald Trump was for the war in 2002. That's when he had that little Howard Stern interview that everybody keeps playing. But Donald Trump was for the war right up until 2004. The war started in 2003. In 2004, when it all started going to hell and it didn't look like it was going to be easy in, easy out, and Bush put on a cod piece and stood on his ship and said, oh, we're not really fighting anymore. Major combat operations in Iraq have ended. In the battle for Iraq, the United States has prevailed. That's what he said. But the ship, we found out, was positioned just off San Diego, not in the Gulf. He was wearing a codpiece and a flight suit, which was interesting. It was much more interesting than the choice of clothing that Hillary has chosen. Or she's gone back to the pantsuit. I'm very happy.
I keep saying, where are her gays?
Yeah, she needs stylists. I do too. Listen, I'm not, you know, it's not casting stones when you live in a glass house, because you know, any advice, any help you could give, I'm there. Okay, I'm exactly. She's a pear shape. Turn the pear over. That's me. But she was wearing traffic cones. But Bush was wearing a codpiece. And then after that, that's when Donald Trump turned against the war. That's when Donald Trump kept saying, I said, no, you didn't. I told anybody who would listen to me. No, you didn't. You told nobody that would listen to you. And yes, he's surrounded by hedge fund managers. That is his entire economic team. In fact, he has no policy experts on his economic team. He has Stephen Miller, a former aide to Senator Jeff Sessions of Alabama. You know, let's look at what the Republicans have done to our economy. Let's look what they repeatedly do to our economy. You know, when Bill Clinton came in, when Barack Obama came in, same thing. They inherited from a Bush. They inherited a terrible recession. They inherited a tanking economy. They inherited massive unemployment numbers and bad deficits and debt, right? And Bill Clinton paid down the debt. Invested in people, put more money in their pockets, earned income tax credit, empowerment zones, community development. Bill Clinton increased the minimum wage, which people forget. Do Republicans ever increase the minimum wage? No, Donald Trump says your wages are too high and you're just going to have to come to grips with it if you want to compete in the global economy.
Wages too high. We're not going to be able to compete against the world. I hate to say it, but we have to leave it the way it is.
Okay, so this is what the GOP stands for. They stand for lowering expectations. They stand for, you know, a defunding education. Bill Clinton put so much money into education. He put money into technology, this big technology revolution we saw, low-cost computers for the inner city, low-cost internet access for people who couldn't afford it. $1 billion was invested in bringing the internet to places that never thought that they would have a computer on their desk, let alone now in your pocket, or some of you have it on your wrist. It's kind of creepy. But we invested in schools and business and communities. And as soon as you get a Republican, they go right after these community groups, right? This is what Breitbart was famous for, Andrew Breitbart. He went after Acorn, which was simply trying to get voters to register, and edited tape and made poor Shirley Sherrod, who was an awesome woman, she still is, made her look like a racist. This is what they do. And that's what he did last night, too.
We're going to reject bigotry. And I will tell you, the bigotry of Hillary Clinton is amazing.
Hillary's the biggest.
She sees communities of color only as votes and not as human beings worthy of a better future. It's only votes.
Oh, he's so smarmy. He's so disgusting. And he's such a world heavyweight champion liar. Hillary Clinton is a bigot. Has she said some things that she probably would take back in a heartbeat if we had a chance to talk to her? I bet you if you asked her about that, she'd say, I never should have said it. But listen to him last night with the gangs. And he said the same damn crap. He's, I'm the law and order guy, and I'll break up the gangs, and it'll happen quickly, people. It'll happen fast.
On crime, we're going to add more police.
More
investigators, and appoint the best judges and prosecutors in the world.
Okay.
On Tuesday in Wisconsin, I talked about how we're going to restore law and order to this country. We need law and order. Without it, we have nothing. The chaos and violence on our streets and the assault on law enforcement are really and truly an attack against all peaceful citizens. If I'm elected president, this chaos and violence will end, and it will end very, very quickly.
Very quickly. It's all going to happen very quickly. You're going to wake up on November 9th. ISIS will be defeated. Law and order will be restored. Security will be yours. Prosperity will, permeate the land. The sky will open. The angels will weep. Gangs will be gone. Cartels will be broken up. Very quickly. It all happened very... Everything he said last night, it's all going to happen very quickly. I really didn't understand what the hell he was doing last night, except to say he is asking for the African-American vote. He is. And he's trying to tell you you've been scammed, which is so insulting because it implies that African-Americans don't know the Clintons, don't know their record, and have to be told how to vote. Are you freaking kidding me? Your disdain and your diminishment of African Americans is such a stereotype in your head that keeps playing over and over again. And you just can't make yourself think any differently because it's obvious. He sees African Americans as being less than. Just by being African Americans, they're operating at a complete mental disadvantage. You got to stop looking at the Laffer curve, Pete. Stop, put down the bell curve, Donald. Get into the 21st century. There is a burgeoning middle class, which is what's freaking out your supporters.
All things Randy at RandiRhodes.com.
Go for launch.
Speaking truth to power, the Randi Rhodes Show.
Mary had a little man.
The fault. We believe that all men are created equal.
To the magnificent mosaic that is America.
From radio beacon to radio beacon.
I have a dream.
Change has come to America.
I love you, Randi.
Knock, knock. Who's there?
It's a figment of your imagination.
Randi Rhodes Show. Turn up your mind.
We should only admit into this country those who share our values and respect our people. I call it extreme vetting. I call it extreme vetting.
Tremendous!
Donald Trump's new ideological screening test will weed out extremists with
extreme views about religion, such as its oppression of women, gays, and non-believers.
That's right. Trump wants prospective Americans to embrace religious freedom, gender equality, and gay rights. At a recent rally in Wisconsin, his fans were on board.
I am for extreme vetting. I am.
I think it is a good idea.
Extreme vetting. Think that's a good idea?
Of course. He forgot one thing. Just make him eat some bacon.
These guys were pumped about America's values of tolerance, so I knew they'd pass Trump's test with flying colors. Fill in the blank for me. Two men getting married is blank.
Disgusting.
Actually, the answer is legal in the United States.
It's legal, but I don't like it.
It's important to believe in, you know, to have respect for everyone's religion.
So you respect Christianity?
I do.
Judaism?
Yes.
Islam?
No.
Can a woman be president?
The presidency is a man's job.
I have women are qualified to be president.
No. A female has more hormones. She could start a war in 10 seconds. If she has hot flashes, whatever. Boom.
Haven't all wars been started by men?
Yes.
Do you think a gay couple should have the same rights as a...
No, I don't. I really don't. I don't think it's fair.
To the gay couple?
Well, no, but the regular couple, they work so hard, you know, and the gay couple, they want more.
Do you, when you say more, do you mean equal?
Yeah, they want equal.
And that's just too much.
Yeah.
No, that's the wrong answer. Sorry, hold on. Turns out Trump's ideology test was going to be harder than I thought.
Whenever I hear president, I think of man. It's a man's job. What sort of, I may be...
Close-minded.
No, yeah, well, no.
Misogynistic?
No.
You're voting against your own interests.
That's it. Thank you very much.
These extreme nations, they don't treat women with respect.
We treat women with respect here.
Yes, we do.
That's an American ideal.
Yeah.
Tell me about your shirt. What's it say?
It says, Hillary sucks. But not like Monica.
Oh, geez.
Hilarious. So we were talking about treating women with respect.
It's an American ideal that we treat women with respect.
You got to give me the back of that shirt one more time. That's too much fun.
Trump that bitch!
We don't even see the irony in it. I love it, right?
As passionate as these guys were, they just weren't passing Trump's ideological test. Luckily, there was still time to study.
This will just help you prep for the test. So if you take it again, you'll be more welcome here. This is a DVD of the third season of Will and Grace.
Okay.
Some really likable and not too gay people. This one is going to be good for you.
Not too gay.
Gloria Steinem. This really humanizes women.
As us feminists, we have so much work to be done, you know.
You a feminist?
No.
Obviously, extreme vetting was necessary to weed out extremists. But until this plan was in place, were any of us safe?
Are you afraid the extremists are already here right now?
They could be anywhere.
They could be right here.
They could be.
Yeah. He could be over there. He could be that guy or this guy. He could be anybody.
He could be anybody.
Beautiful. That's from The Daily Show. So check this out, okay? You remember when Barack Obama had won the primary and we knew that he was going to be our Democratic nominee and, you know, it was time for everybody to fall in line behind Barack Obama and let's not go down the Puma road, but some people know what the Pumas were. And anyway, the party started getting united and we knew that Barack Obama was going to be president. And people started calling this show, especially African-American women started calling this show. And they were terrified. And it never dawns on a white person why a black person would be terrified that the first African-American president was about to be elected and inaugurated. Well, they schooled me on that. And suddenly, oh, I still get chills when I think about it. They just knew that it was going to increase racism in this country to a degree that we had not lived through if, you know, you were born after 1964. You know what I mean? You had never lived through, the Jim Crow. You had never lived through the lynching. You had never lived through slavery. You know, you never lived through segregation. You never lived through any of those things. And now all of a sudden, it was going to make a comeback. Well, some very smart girl, I must say. There are a few magazines. There's a few magazines that you have to read. I mean, if you really want to, understand the world in which you toil, the country in which you devote your life and your hard work. If you want to understand the government, if you want to understand what's wrong with politics or what's wrong with this candidate or what's wrong with that candidate, that there is no such thing as the purest person on the planet running for the presidency, then you should read. And one of the things, I love Vanity Fair. Vanity Fair is it's like such a good mix. Do you know what I mean? It's almost as good as when Larry Flint mixed Christianity with porn. That was a great era. You know, I still get a Christmas card every year from Larry Flint. Do you know that? I love you, Larry. People versus Larry Flint fought for the First Amendment. Because of guys like him, I get to do what I want to do. So I'm very grateful to Larry Flint. However, he had this period where he mixed pornography with Christianity because he became friends with Jimmy Carter's sister after he got shot by some Christian anti-pornography activist, right? And that's why Larry Flint is in a wheelchair to this day. Okay, so if you want to have a magazine that mixes fashion with politics in that weird way, that's Vanity Fair. It is the perfect, perfect magazine. Another great one is The Atlantic. Love that. Except these, I will tell you, Vanity Fair and The Atlantic, they practice something that, see, every redneck's going to tune me out now. It's called long-form journalism. Well, darling, the only thing I want long is on a Friday night somewhere around midnight. Yeah, I understand. But these are long-form articles. These are really in-depth, really well-researched, seriously fact-checked, well-written, entertaining in the way that the writing is so awesomely good. And so in The Atlantic, you know, I always have to look at it every morning to see, you know, like what they're covering, and I sign up for their subscription and blah, blah. Anyway, it doesn't cost anything. It'll just come to your inbox. It's really great. There's a woman, her name's Michelle Cottle, and she wrote this article. Oh, by the way, before I get into Michelle Cottle's article, which is really worth reading, I'll tweet it later, and I will. Finally, Captain Leary, who I, you know, gave orders to go on this mission, He went on his mission, and he completed his mission. Mission accomplished.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Holy crap, man. Last night I was sitting there editing this Trump monstrosity where he apologized for some damn thing to some damn body. I don't know. But I was cutting that, and I get an email. And it's from Captain Leary, and he goes, I finally freaking did it. You're not going to believe this, but I got your name back on Twitter. So I'm now at Randi Rhodes. Oh, my God.
Mission accomplished.
Holy, I salute you. I salute you. I really do, Captain. I mean, that was your commander gave you an order, and you freaking carried that out to the best of your abilities and accomplished your mission. So now we it's fine. I mean, you know, if you go to at Randi Rhodes, you'll get everything that we were tweeting prior to it. But it's much easier to find because it's now my damn name. So now your next mission is to go get the blue check. I want to be verified.
That is in the pipeline.
Twitter, get off your ass. You're making him look bad. And he did a great thing. He did a great thing. That was a great thing. That was a really, really great thing. You know, I had to go through that, too, when I was making this website, the new one for this show, randirhodes.com. I had to get that back, too, because I didn't, I mean, I owned it, but I didn't have possession of it. See, it belonged to me, but it was in the possession of the evil empire. And I had to go through their hoops and you know, blah blah blah, and they finally returned it to me, and that's how we were able to build it. But Twitter, I didn't know anybody there, so that was difficult.
It was my mission, and everybody that was following is automatically following, so everything is the same.
Yeah,
and
they imported all of you, they imported all my tweets, they imported everything. So I'm going to tweet this in a little while, okay? But this is, it's called, this is by Michelle Cottle in The Atlantic, okay? It's called The Era of the Bitch is Coming. And when you first read that, this is a brilliant title because people who hate Hillary will say, you know, you tweet this out, and they're going to retweet it and stuff. You'll see. It's going to be a great experiment we'll do tonight. But the era of the bitch is coming. What is this article about? It's about what those African-American women, God love you, in my audience were schooling me on back in 2004. They were telling me how frightened they were that an African-American male was going to be the president and how it was going to increase hostility and racism and bigotry in this country. And bam, it did. Well, Michelle Cottle takes that same position about what's going to happen to women when Hillary becomes the first female president, when Hillary becomes the first woman president. And you know what? I read this thing. It's not that long. It's only 5 pages. And for The Atlantic, that's a good thing because it could be 20. You could be in for the, you could have to sacrifice your entire Saturday morning in the John there till your legs go numb and you get the ring embedded. Oh, please. I'm a real person just like you. But this is so great. Let me just read you one sentence, and then we'll tweet it, okay? A Clinton victory promises to usher in 4 to 8 years of the kind of down-and-dirty public misogyny you might expect from a stag party at Roger Ailes' house. Michelle Cottle is correct. That's beautiful. That's beautiful. So, you know, we as women, we have to prepare. I can't wait to feel those phone calls. I can't wait. I'm just now, you know, getting desensitized to the lunatics on the internets in real time. You know, the ones that will tweet you, the ones that will Facebook you, the ones that will. The Facebook is okay because you could delete them. You know, the chat room, that's like so instant and it's so bad and it's so, you know, and also these Trump chat rooms where they play Nazi music while they're waiting for Trump to take the stage. Those are the most vicious, virulent rodents in our entire country. Those people are rats. They come from families of rats. They're all a bunch of rats. They're rats. They're vermin. Oh, and they can't make a sentence. They cannot. It's just a group of words that they throw at a piece of, you know, that they throw at, they type in a group of words and they think somehow it's translating. It ain't freaking translating. All right, let's finish up the day with you guys, Amy and Nutley.
Oh, thanks, Randi.
Yeah.
Good to, good to be on again. I'm a little bit annoyed at that guy that called earlier that said, I don't want Hillary in the White House because of Bill. Well, you know what? I don't want Trump in the White House because of Melania there.
I have no problem with Melania, but I do have a problem with Trump. And by the way, I doubt Trump would live in the White House. It would be too small for him. It would be, you know, first of all, he'd probably tear it down and rebuild it.
I mean, it's ridiculous. I'm just so tired. The misogyny has already started, Randy.
Yes, I mean the man has what? The man has three wives and five children by three different women. What are they worried about Bill for? He's 70 years old.
I mean, he's retired. Give me a break. But why, when has a man ever been elected because of his wife? Or it's just they always make this comparison about, well, she can't be, she has a very long list of accomplishments. And, people should just go to what the fuck has Hillary done?
is that a thing? Is that a place?
That is a thing.
Okay.
There's actually a website called What the Fuck Has Hillary Done?
I'm writing it down.
And you get her a list of accomplishments. And, and just because you don't like, three out of 10 things about her doesn't mean that you shouldn't vote for her.
I agree.
Election.
I'm sure there are plenty of things about you that your significant other, your husband, your boyfriend, your girlfriend doesn't like about you, but she loves you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we should make this so easy for people to comprehend. This person that you love, whoever that is, or that child that is the treasure of your universe, perfect. Is there anything about them that you don't like? Anything at all? Okay, good. So does that mean you don't love them? You don't support them? You're not with them? You're against them? Smarten up, people. Smarten the hell up. Your choices are Hillary Clinton, who is an accomplished woman who has made some errors in judgment. There's no question that Iraq war vote was an error in judgment, in my opinion, because all the information was out there. I had it. And I will never forget that I had it. And those aluminum tubes turned out to be like lawn chairs, okay? So, Jessica calls me up, and no matter how busy I am and what I'm doing, she starts talking about her life. And I told her last night, I said, I'm in the middle of something. She goes, oh, fine, I'll talk to you some other time. Click. Now, that's snarky. That's not, that's rude. But I love that girl. I support her with every ounce of my being. So after I was done, I called her back up and I said, beginning a conversation with, is this a good time for you? Oh, that's really smart. I needed those words. Problem solved. Lennon, New York.
Hi, how you doing?
Good.
I'm watching Donald Trump on TV.
I am too, in this goofy hat.
I emailed Hillary campaign and said, he got all this free media by simply popping up at this time of day through 8 o'clock. And she has to just do the same to grab the camera because it's just simply, if you're there, they'll shoot you. Of course, I'd love to see him shot.
What do you mean?
Terrible, terrible joke. No, I'm saying, he's giving these press conferences like he did during the, or speeches like he did during the primary.
He's saying, it's okay, the more he talks, the worse his poll numbers get. He's saying something so offensive right now. He is he's asking African Americans, what do you have to lose? As if they are a monolithic group that has nothing. That's, his stereotype of the entire African American population of this country is on full display here. Honest to God,
there's someone with a tan in the background, though. I'm only kidding.
I think he's Asian.
I think he's just tanned.
I think he's Asian. I do. I think he's Asian. But honest to God, man, the more he talks, the worse it gets. Let him talk. Let him talk. Let him talk, talk, talk. He is going to take the 16 million voters that voted for him in the primary, and he's going to turn them into an audience for alt-right, which is neo-Nazi, white conservatism, white supremacist, Nazi, let's put a Jewish star on Hillary's face and say that the money's with her, and then say, leave the star up, leave the star. That's what he's going to do. And you know what's going to happen? unless Donald Trump is on that channel 24/7 every single day, no one's going to watch it. I shouldn't say no one, because there is an audience for, you know, Alex Jones, which kills me. It killed, you know, these people are just, they're too stupid to breathe.
Call in, connect. To speak to Randi, call 561-270-3844. 561-270-3844.
We did it, you bastards! We're live! And it only took 2 years! Okay. All right. So we're back, we're live, and you're there, and we're here, and ain't that great? Now let me just tell you that if you want to listen whenever and wherever you'd like to listen, just go to randirhodes.com, click on podcasts and swag, and get your podcast commercial free on demand on any device. randirhodes.com. Open all day, every day.
The Randi Rhodes Air Force. The Randi Rhodes Show is live on RandiRhodes.com and the free Progressive Voices app for Android and iOS. Visit the App Store or ProgressiveVoices.com now.
Now.
On crime, I am going to support more police in our communities, appoint the best prosecutors and judges in the country, pursue strong enforcement of federal laws, and I'm going to break up the gangs, the cartels, and the criminal syndicates terrorizing our neighborhoods all over the country, and that includes Milwaukee.
What? And then he said, it's going to happen quickly. It's just, you know, because he has thought of things that no one has ever thought of before. It's amazing. Oh, it's amazing. Yeah. So he knows what you know what to do. Has absolutely nothing to do with more social services or better education or not suspending kids from school for like 100 days so that they, you know, they're wandering around or rehab centers, you know. Has nothing to do with any of that. No, it has to do with putting even more police on the street. you know, the day that Donald Trump says we need criminal justice reform will be the day that Hillary says Islamic extreme terrorism or whatever. And the reason why we don't say that is because it trashes an entire religion. So instead, we call them ISIS. So we're very specific about these 20,000 lunatics that are part of a death cult and probably on meth. They're like a freaking crazy biker gang. Oh, and the bikers are for Trump, too. Because they ride without helmets, so that makes sense. Noble in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Hi, Ms. Rhodes.
Hello.
I just discovered your show today, and I'm going to tell you that I'm watched every day. It's one of the greatest shows that I've ever heard.
Well, thank you. I'm so happy that you found us. How'd you find us?
Just YouTube.
Just looking? Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about your caller that calls you about the racism for black people after Obama was elected president.
Well, it was during the primary when we realized, it was past the primary when he won, and it was right as he was about to, you know, it was obvious that he was winning in the poll and that he would win. And,
yeah.
And people were very, very scared that, or black women especially, were really, really calling me a lot saying that they thought that racism was going to go through the roof, and it did.
And you are absolutely correct on your era of the bitch.
Yeah, I wish I would have thought of it myself, but you know what? I didn't even think about it. It's just I didn't think about the African American community's feelings about Obama either until, you know, the women. That's why I say that I'm so grateful that I have a really nice sized African American audience, especially the women. I'm so grateful to them. They've taught me so much over these years. But this Michelle Cottle girl, she's the one in The Atlantic that wrote this, and all of a sudden I was like, oh, damn, she's right. It's going to every woman's going to be called a bitch. We're going to hear about bleeding from our eyeballs and various other body parts that we are, you know, we have hormones and therefore we could blow up the world. Yeah, all this stuff's going to come at us.
It is.
I
and,
know.
I've already been a victim of women believing that they have a higher standing in society. So,
oh, you know, I know what you mean.
You know, yeah, they think that, you know, we're going to have a woman president, things are going
to
change.
Okay, well, here's my best advice to you. Just wrap your brain around this. Women run the world, whether you know it
sure.
or not. And now we're really going to be honest about it. We're going to put a face on the actual running of the world.
Yes.
So,
can I tell you something else that nobody's ever heard?
Yeah.
The reason why Hillary Clinton and the Libya thing, it was so big, and nobody's ever said this. There was two children in Nuremberg, Germany, killed in the early 80s by the Islamic terrorists that came from Libya that bombed the nightclub in Berlin.
Right.
In front of I was almost abducted by these terrorists. I was at school that day, and they tried to get me in the car.
In Berlin?
In Nuremberg, Germany.
Oh, in Nuremberg.
Yeah, no, this is classified information. So they caught two kids, they decapitated them, left them in a van in front of our school. And it was never on any news site or anywhere it's classified.
Okay, well, that means I can't check out your story.
Yeah, you can't.
I can't.
But I'm gonna tell you this. We've had a death warrant for Gaddafi since then. And that's how they couldn't kill him because...
We've been trying to kill Gaddafi for years. The Bush administration,
yeah,
the first one, they
yes.
tried to kill... Everybody tries to kill Gaddafi.
Because of those two kids.
Yeah.
The day after that, they found...
I don't think that's why, but everybody has tried to kill Gaddafi. I mean, they killed his... Didn't they kill his daughter? Didn't they kill, you know...
Yeah, that's why they killed the two kids in our school. Because after the bombing, after we reacted and bombed them, they came over and got two kids from...
Well, I have no way of checking that out, and you're telling me it's classified information, so why would you say it? I mean, do you not respect the oath that you took to protect the classified information? Ed the Teamster.
Hey, Randi.
Hi, Teamster.
Hi. Took a while to get through, but that's a wonderful thing.
That's a good thing.
Thing,
isn't it? It's a great problem to have. Yeah.
Oh, that's a very good thing. And it's also a very good thing. The last time we talked, the polls were a heck of a lot different then than they are now.
Yeah.
So that's great. The reason I was calling was I was telling Howard I would really like to see Clinton win, would get the Senate back, and in my dream of dreams, also get the House back.
Oh, yeah.
But what got me was when she gave that full-throttle endorsement of Deborah Mee Wasserman Schultz.
Yeah, well, you know what?
And I'm like, stop. My point is, and then after that, it was the Ken Zellerthar appointment, and I can kind of live with that one. But
right.
In order to get the Senate and maybe the House, stop doing stuff like that. I mean, especially the Wasserman Schultz endorsement, that was just slapping us Bernie supporters upside the head.
Yeah, it was bad. It was bad, and I will not vote for Debbie Wasserman Schultz. And you know, guess where I live? So I'm.
Oh yeah, I know.
Yeah,
I know.
I'm voting for Tim Canova. So you know.
Yeah, my first thing was when I saw that was to send him some money. So, but I just, you know, on the one hand, I'm really glad that things have switched around as far as the polls. It's looking good, but on the other hand, I'm thinking more people who might have voted might see stuff like that and stay
yeah.
home.
Yeah, well,
that
I hope they
that
don't.
Might mean not
I hope they
the
don't.
Senate.
I hope they don't because the election is just one day. Okay, and then.
Oh, yeah.
And then, you know, you have to stay involved and then you have to vote again in 2018 for, you know, in the midterms. And if we should take the Senate, and I think we have a really good chance of that, the courts, this is the part about the House that really, you know, upsets me. The courts in many, many states, as you now can see, have been overturning the gerrymandering and the,
the voter repression
and the voter ID laws and all that.
Right.
Except that this election will still be operational under the old maps and under the old rules. And that pretty much sucks. But at least in 2018, we'll have another shot at the House. If they can't gerrymander these maps, and you know, it's so funny, but the feds said it. This isn't just the states. The federal court, they looked at you know, a whole bunch of states, but the one I have in front of me is North Carolina's gerrymandered maps are unconstitutional. And that, you know, they said that this was obviously a racial thing. They said Judge Roger Gregory's opinion for a majority of the panel not only holds that two of the state's congressional districts are the product of an unconstitutional racial gerrymandering. It requires that new districts be drawn within 2 weeks of the entry of this opinion to remedy the unconstitutional districts. So that was supposed to happen last year. They appealed it so that they could get into this election cycle with those old and because of the time it took, this election will go forward with the old maps. See, this is the game that gets played, and this is the
That's why we need a huge turnout.
That's not only a huge turnout, but this is why you need to stay involved throughout the whole entire system. You know, listen, and what really is sad in a way. I think, you know, I think my audience is smarter than the average bear. I think we're much more plugged in. I think that, you know, we read more. I think that we're better educated. I think that, you know, our experiences in life are more diverse than, you know, somebody who tonight will beat their wife with a box of Tide and then go shoot squirrels. I just do. So I think that our audience understands that it's not just the president that matters, that it's the House of Representatives that matter, especially on tax issues, because all stuff like that has to start in the House, and that the Senate matters because of that filibuster that they can block anything with one, you know, obstinate guy reading Green Eggs and Ham all day. I think we get that, but I, you know, I worry during presidential cycles that nobody pays any attention to any other part of what's going to be on the ballot. And it all matters. Every damn bit of it matters, especially the local stuff. That matters in your backyard more than it matters in mine, you know? So it's, I mean, we're broadcasting all over the place. We have, you know, the other day I saw we had 189 people listening in Russia.
They want to call in on Skype.
What are you doing there? And why do you hate us so much? I was there. I was visiting you. And you people were just horrendously rude. And why do you drink so much vodka? It's not a stereotype. They do. They drink it all day, every day. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. They are drunk, drunk people. They handle it better than we do. Look what we do. Ryan Lochte goes and pees in a gas station in Brazil. He whizzes on the floor. Okay, that's, I don't know who that is.
Me again.
Oh, why are you back?
Because I didn't get to talk to you about what I called about.
Okay, well, call another day. Paul in Woodinville, Washington.
Yeah, not me again.
No, that takes a lot of nerve, I think. And people that call every day, you know, every single day. I don't put them on the air. We should make some rules here, okay? 30 days. Call every 30 days. Thank you.
They're not even that gay.
Yeah.
Well, you know, we have to win. We have three cycles. We have 2016, 2018, and 2020 to take back state legislatures.
Yeah.
That's the key, because that's who draws the, that does the redistricting.
It's not, that's a very big issue, the redistricting, but also, those are the people that make the state budgets, and those are the people who decide if they're going to invest in prisons or they're going to invest in education. For instance, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, okay? Everybody was focused all of a sudden on Milwaukee. Now, he was only in West Bend. He never went to Milwaukee to tell the black people anything. He talked to lily white people like he's doing today about black people because he's scared of black people, and he didn't want to go to Milwaukee because he was frightened for his own freaking safety. However, this state is run by Scott Walker. And Scott Walker invested 127% more in prisons and slashed education. Look at Ricky Snyder in next door in Michigan. His pipes are full of lead. Okay,
I know that. I'm from
Michigan. Literally right, and yeah. He's literally poisoning an entire city known as Flint, Michigan, and the man is not in jail. So if Donald Trump wants to talk to me about crime and punishment, let's talk about crime, real crime, massive, massive murders, massive poisoning of the masses. Let's talk about the corruption. Let's talk about every candidate freely and fairly, and who said what and who did what and who did what, who poisoned people and got away with it. I mean, honestly, there's no discussion about anything, you know, local.
Well, the reason it's so important is, and the reason we're in the position we're in now, is or at least the Democratic Party, is because the pure progressives got all disenchanted and then got their panties in a bunch in 2010 and didn't show up because Obamacare didn't have a public option, which nobody really understood anyway, and didn't show up. And that was the year of the census, and that's when the Republicans took over the majority of state legislatures and redistricted. Last 2014, Democrats got 4 million more votes in the Congress for congressional House representatives, and still lost seats, still lost more seats than ever before.
Right, gerrymandering. So, exactly.
Yeah,
exactly. But let's review because you just brought something up that I think we need to just put out there. The reason why people didn't show up in 2010 was Obamacare didn't have a public option. We still had Don't Ask, Don't Tell. He hadn't repealed it yet because he was doing things in a We were still in Afghanistan. And people just decided that they didn't agree with these three things. So they stayed marriage wasn't legalized and pot wasn't legal. And they stayed. Now, you can't do that in the middle of progress. You know, because it doesn't happen in the order in which you would have prioritized things. You can't not be involved. You can't stay home.
Well, and that's what I'm talking about, the progressive purity test, which makes me think is that why do people think that Jill Stein is some other Mother Teresa of progressivism when you know what she really is? She's a political parasite.
Why?
Why?
Yeah.
I'll tell you why. It's exactly what we're talking about. I like Jill Stein. I like her position. She's very smart.
Right.
But who is she counting on to accomplish her legislative agenda? Heavy, heavy, heavy-duty Democratic domination in the United States Congress and in state legislatures.
Well, this is my beef. I wouldn't call her parasite, but I would say that these third parties really need to spend these off years, you know, like I said, being involved in growing their party. Because lots of things have to change, from the gerrymandered maps and the way the districts are drawn to the Electoral College. That has to change. I mean, there's so many things that have to change in order to make America a third party viable country that's a whole day's show about listing all the things that would have to happen. But they don't party build. They don't, to the point where Bernie Sanders is an independent. His heart is an independent's heart. Okay. But he had to become a Democrat to run for president. Because,
well, you know, look what happened in 1980. I was one of the people who voted for John Anderson and helped Ronald Reagan be president because I had a real purity test.
Yeah, yeah.
You see what I mean?
Yes, I do.
And that was a big mistake, even though I knew he would lose.
Except in 1980, I voted for Ronald Reagan.
Oh, Randy.
It was like my first vote.
All things Randy at RandyRhodes.com.
Go for launch.
Speaking truth to power, the Randi Rhodes Show. For a commercial-free, on-demand, whenever, wherever listening experience, visit RandyRhodes.com for your personal premium podcast today.
I was young, I was stupid, and I was in the military when I voted for Ronald Reagan. And just so you know, I joined because I thought there was a GI Bill, because there was. And then when I got out after Reagan was president, there wasn't. So I paid for that vote. Literally paid for it. Mike in Wisconsin.
Oh, Randy, I got through. How you doing, girl?
Hey, how you doing?
I'm all right. Mike Rice, to call you Mike from Milwaukee.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Hey. Hey, Mike.
Hey, what's up, girl? Yeah. I see that black shirt you got on. I got me one just like those.
Woohoo! Yeah.
You know, I almost fell off my office chair when I heard you on Stephanie Miller saying that you're coming back. As soon as I heard that and you directed me where to go, I came to credit card right in my office.
You're a doll. Hey, just so you know, following up from yesterday, I said I would reach out to her for the to be on her Happy Hour podcast.
I heard that.
I did write her an email, and I haven't heard back from her, so ball's in her court, dear.
Okay.
All right.
I was calling to remind you about this conversation we had, and you've been alluding to this for a while now about these voting cycles and how people get mad and take their ball and go home and they don't vote in these midterm elections.
Yep.
And I remember how you used to always say, you know, if you want to get the things that President Obama wants to get done, you got to give him a Congress he can work with.
Exactly.
And you know, the other caller stole my thunder. But I was telling Howard, you know, how we had this conversation about defensive voting. I don't know if you remember that, but that stuck in my head. Like, you got to get out and you got to protect the House and you got to protect the Senate.
Yep.
You got to make sure that your president, who is not a king, he is not a king and she will not be a queen. They have got to have a Congress they can work with and that can get their agenda through. They can't push it through on their own, and that's what President Obama ran into.
Exactly.
Everybody's sitting here like, well, how did that shutting down Gitmo work for you? How did this work for you? I go, it didn't work well at all because you got Republicans he's trying to work with who on day one took a blood oath almost.
Oh, yeah.
And we're going to work against this man no matter what he does. We're going to obstruct. And they've done it. They've done it the whole time.
This is my favorite clip from the whole Obama era in the Senate, okay?
If we're able to stop Obama on this, it will be his Waterloo. It will break him.
That was what they did. And, you know, they were meeting as Obama was being sworn in, saying we will not do anything this president wants, even if it's good for, you know, our constituents, even if it's good for our clients. And by that, I mean, you know, the money givers, the donors. We're not doing jack crap. We're not going to do anything. Nothing.
Right.
We're going to make him the least successful president that's ever come down the pike because we don't want a black man in the White House.
Right.
Period. And America will think twice before they ever do something like that again. And it's about to happen again with a woman. And they're going to do it all over again. And that's why we need to have the Senate this time. We need to have the House. And then when everybody gets all comfortable and happy because the minimum wage will go up and we will see, you know, the lowest poverty rate again. And we will see, you know, an investment in schools and the infrastructure, roads, bridges, blah, blah, blah. And people, blue collar guys will be back to work. And won't that be great? Then they'll say, oh, I don't have to vote. I don't have to vote.
Right. And remember, folks, the one thing that President Obama said at the convention, which people don't get, I think, you know, I know you get it, and I understand it. I know a lot of other people understand, but I want people to go back and listen to him when he said, and he was talking to Black Lives Matter and all these other movements, if you want real change, then you got to vote for the sheriff, you got to vote for the local judge, you got to vote for the record, the deeds of records guy. All the way down the line, you got to get off your butt and you got to go vote. Politics is not some mamby-pamby thing. You know, you got to get out there and you got to make sure that the governor of your state is on your side, that his legislature is on his side, because when you look at the attacks on Planned Parenthood, when you look at the attacks on the voting rights, when you look at attacks on you know, which bathroom people can use, this is all coming from the state houses. And people have got to get out there and they got to vote these people out and put people in who will help move the country forward.
Exactly. You're right. And I remember what he said. And he was talking about criminal justice reform. And he said, so, you know what? He goes, you got to vote for your DA. You got to vote for your sheriff. That's where the law, you know, you got to vote for your city council. That's where the laws are made. That's where, you know, and the governor is deciding how much goes to education, how much goes to private prisons, whether or not he's going to expand Medicaid, whether or not he's going to allow, you know, competition in the health care exchanges, whether he's going to have a health care exchange. I mean, these are all issues that affect everybody every single day of their life, and they look at the president. Well, the president doesn't do that.
Right. So, like I said, and I'll get off the phone here, but I'm so glad you're back. You just don't know how glad I am you're back. And now, if we could just get John Stewart back, we'd have our team. We'd have you during the day. We'd have John Stewart on at night just preaching and breaking down all these lies to us and keeping us, like you always have that homework for us. I kid you not, and I'm not saying this just because I'm on the air with you, but you're the one radio show that keeps me intellectually curious. You'll say things, and out of the blue sometimes I'll write it down, I'll throw it in my briefcase, I'll come home, and then I'll start reading about all these different things that you talked about during the day. And I think that's the gift that you give to us, and that's what people miss. When I hear people calling in now and they sound like me, you know. They miss that, you know. This person, Randi Rhodes, would make us, you know, through her way of delivering things. Is that true what she's talking about? It must be true. Randi wouldn't lie to us. Well, let me just go check, because you used to always say, don't believe what I'm telling you. Go look it up. And here's where you start. I'll put your nose on the scent, and you continue to educate yourself about
exactly.
What you want, and I'll keep the conversation going here. So
exactly.
So back on the air, keep it up, and then let's get the house. Let's get the Senate, and then let's get that house, and then let's if it has to be Hillary's our girl, then Hillary's our girl right now, and we're gonna have to ride that like Al Sharpton said. We're gonna have to ride this person now for the next, you know, 8 years. But we gotta get these Republicans out of the Congress, because they do nothing. They sit on their hands. They're the reason why the economy is not way better than what it should be right now.
Absolutely. No doubt about it. And you know, just to review, when Obama came into office, of course, he had to clean up the Republican mess, which is always, always what has to be done when you're a Democrat. Clean up the Republican mess. The beauty about the continuity of another Democratic presidency is that the mess isn't as messy as it would be if she was coming in after a Donald Trump or George,
right?
So she can really move forward really pretty quickly. And I have high hopes. I really do. Will there be disappointments? Yes. Will people call him and go, but you said she would do this? And you said, just remember, I didn't say she'd do anything.
Right.
Okay. In the first 100, because I don't know what Congress looks like yet. You show me after the election what the Congress that Hillary Clinton, the president of the United States, gets, and I'll tell you how fast things can get done and how fast you should expect them to be done and what should get done and what to look for coming down the pike. But if you give her, you know, you make a mixed marriage, you know, you put a Shia in the presidency and you put the Sunnis in the Congress,
right,
nothing gets done. Nothing.
All right, Randi.
Bye. Well, thanks, Mike. Have a great weekend. Thank you for calling me. It's good to hear from you, too. All right, Sharon in Virginia.
Hi.
Hey.
Hey, how you doing?
Good.
I'm so happy that you are back on the air.
Thank you.
And just informing us, just like the last caller, he just pretty much stole my thunder, but that's okay. I'm in Virginia, and like Michael was telling Howard, I'm calling about ballot initiatives, and it's very important that each person, that even if you plan on voting for Jill Sun, whoever, it's important to look up the ballot initiatives in each state, in the state that you're in, so that way you go to the polls and you know exactly what you are voting about.
Right. And, you know, there is, they send sample ballots out, but if you didn't get your sample ballot, now would be a good time to go look at your sample ballot.
That's what I did.
Yeah. And start to research some of these people and issues, because, yes, you know, there are judges on there and they don't mm-hmm. have some places, like most places, they don't have party affiliation and you don't know who they are.
That's
and you
right.
don't know what they're about and you don't know That's if right. they're, you know, going to be part of the criminal justice reform or they're going to be anti-criminal justice reform, and we intend to reform criminal justice and make it equal, like it says on the Supreme Court, chiseled up there in the granite, in the marbles. It says equal justice under law. Well, we don't have that, you know, we don't. So it's important. There are judges on your ballot. There are initiatives on your ballot. There are questions on your ballot. Could be anything. Could be whether or not you legalize marijuana. Could be. And sometimes the way they're written seems like they're amenable to your position, but there's like four double negatives in one sentence. And so you're going to have to sit there and spend a minute and figure out if this ballot initiative is for what you're for, or if it's against what you would spit out a spleen being for, all because it's written to bamboozle you. That's another way that they play with you. Brother David.
Oh, sister, what Sharon and the caller before her said, what
yes.
you've been saying all day.
Yeah.
It's so true. Vote down ticket blue, people. Vote, vote, vote down ticket blue. I am standing in the parking lot at Musso and Frank's Grill having a farewell lunch with my professional colleagues in my about-to-be-no ex-journalism profession. And I have to say, it has never been clearer to me that we are the only ones that can let this fall. It's right there for us. No, she's not perfect, but she's a blankety-blank sight better than you-know-who and a lot of you-know-whos that have been before her. And it gives us the wriggle room to continue the movement and to continue and to keep what we've already managed to get. It just seems like a no-brainer to me. Seriously.
Well, you know, the simplest way to say it, on a Friday when everybody's looking forward to, you know, their brewskis.
Beer o'clock
is right around. The simplest way to say it is one is a fascist, the other is not.
Ding, 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 ding.
Okay.
Absolutely.
So,
hi, chat board. I hope you're playing well. Just had to throw that in.
Well, I was going to get on that. I'm reading the chat board, but I got to tell you, I can't post. I don't know why. There's something wrong over here with me, and I can't put any messages.
There is nothing wrong with you, sister.
There's everything wrong with me. There will be in an hour and a half anyway. But hey, listen, thank you. Have a great weekend. I love you.
Love you always.
Thank you for being a big help on the in the chat room. I really appreciate all the work that you're doing. And Joy, too. Thank you, Joy. But I have my name back. I'm so excited. So will you please tweet me, or if you haven't found me on Twitter, now you can, because it's at Randi Rhodes, R-A-N-D-I, Rhodes, R-H-O-D-E-S, at Randi Rhodes. Please tweet, lead, follow me on Twitter, or get out of the freaking way, is basically, you know, what I've decided. So at Randi Rhodes is mine. Please subscribe, it costs nothing, to the YouTube page. We're being judged on those numbers. The Twitter numbers are really stinking important to me, especially now. This next week, I'll tell you about it next week. And you have to like my Facebook page. These things cost nothing. What does cost something that will help us keep the show going, but you get something, is buy a stinking podcast. Please buy a stinking podcast. And if you've already bought a stinking podcast, support the show. Thank you very much. Great weekend, everybody. Spirit clock. Woohoo. Buy a stinking podcast. Hi, it's Randi Rhodes. We missed you today. For the entire show, whenever, wherever, go to randirhodes.com and buy a stinking podcast. And don't forget to catch our show live right here from 4 to 6 Eastern.